Hi, my name is Megan Atevle, and I make interactive floors and interactive walls for a living. And today I'm going to show you how I made this really cool interactive experience that works just as well on the wall as it does on the floor. And all you need to make it are two things: a video, a looping video background, and an image that is a PNG on a transparency. And that's all you're seeing here. But it sure looks cool, right? Let me show you what it looks like on the floor. Come on. This is what the effect looks like on my floor. I think it's pretty cool. And for those of you that have been asking, I have very dark hardwood floors. So I have a piece of what's called Marley floor. It's a light gray vinyl, and that's what I use to treat my floor. You can project on any non-patterned light color, but light gray for me seems to pop the colors a little bit more and increase the contrast, so that's what I recommend. Also, it's really important to use a matte color whether you're projecting on a floor or a wall. Anything that's shiny is going to give you hot spots, and that's just not going to look as good. So let's go over to my computer and I'll show you how I made this. If you watch our tutorials every week, then you might recognize this effect because I tried to make it for a tutorial a few weeks ago and the template didn't do exactly what I wanted it to do. So I ended up asking Curtis, who is responsible for all of the app programming and the software and the templates, if he could make a couple changes. And he did, and that means that I need to redo the tutorial both here and on the website, and I will link to our website full tutorial, which has links and downloadable graphics that you can play with. But he did it in just a matter of a few weeks, and he treats your requests the same way he treats mine. So if you have any questions or you want any changes or features added, you can reach out to us and we'll do our best to get them into the software or into our library as quickly as we can. Now, the first thing that you should always do whenever you make an effect or a game for LUMOplay and you're working on a computer that is not the computer that's going to be running the final installation is just make sure that the resolution matches. So in my case, I'm making a display for a projector that is 1920 by 1080. So that's a 16:9 aspect ratio. And so when I make that effect, I need to make sure that my computer that I'm using to design on is also set to that resolution and that I am making all my graphics for that resolution, because there's no point making your graphics larger than they need to be or more giving them more definition than they need to have. They won't run as well. So that's the first thing that you need to do. For this effect, we're using the particle image template. So I'm just going to find that from the motion maker section. You can see we have a lot of different templates, so there's a lot of different things that you can make with LUMOplay just by uploading your own graphics. I'm going to click Create, and you'll see that when the template is finished loading, there will be some default graphics that show up, and we're just going to be replacing those default graphics. So you can add an overlay, which is like a call to action or a logo that sits on top of the rest of the effect. With a logo image, it's always going to be there, and typically what I would recommend is designing something that just sits in the bottom corner or the top corner. And you can set a logo transparency so you can still see the effect through it if you want to. For masks, these are used to create irregular shapes. So if you wanted to make an effect like this, but you want it to be round instead of a rectangle, you would make a PNG image with a transparency in the middle that's the shape that you want it to be, and just make the background black. And for the idle image, what that is an image that will appear on the screen when there's nothing happening. So this is a really good place to put a call to action in that says, please move to start, or press button to start, or walk across me in the case of a floor. And then that image will disappear once people start engaging with your experience. I'm not going to be putting anything like that into this effect today, but those options are present on every single one of our templates. For the background, I'm going to replace the background with my own video. So I made it pretty frantic, and you'll also see that on this screen it looks really pixelated. And it is, I did compress the crap out of it, I'm not gonna lie. There's a lot of motion going on, and I want to make sure that it runs smoothly even on computers that don't meet our recommended specifications. So I downsampled it like crazy. But with the particles on top of it, as you saw on the wall and on the floor, you don't really notice that. It's really important that the video be a loop and that it be at least a minute long, but I usually try to make my videos about 3 minutes long because we're using Unity as the back end for all of our effects. And Unity just doesn't handle video looping very well, so sometimes you will see the video stutter, and it just doesn't really make the effect feel good. So if you can lengthen that out, that's going to, even if it happens once every 3 minutes, people aren't going to notice it as much. And the other thing to kind of be aware of with these videos is that you can add audio to them. So if I unmute my audio for just a second, you can hear that there's some sound in this effect, and it's just an ambient looping sound that kind of comes in and out. That's optional, but if you do want to add some ambient music, the way to do it is in your video. So I've added the video, and now I'm just going to add some background particles, and these are just particles that appear when you move anywhere that's outside of the image. And what I want to do is match those particles to kind of the blue tint of these particles that are in my video. So I'm just going to select kind of a light blue color here. Good, that looks like it matches really well. And then I'm going to change my particle shape. There's a lot of different shapes that you can choose from. You can have stars, you can have circles. So you can already see there's a lot of really interesting effects that can be created just by changing the shape of the particles. I'm going to change these to nebula, which is the, I think, matches the background video a little bit better than any of the sort of harder lined shapes. And I'm going to just quickly adjust my particle size because I don't want them to be too big. I want them to be pretty subtle. And I'll turn that transparency up just a little bit so that they're a little bit more obvious. And that's it, I'm happy with that. For the image particles, that's where you're going to put in the PNG image that you created that has that transparent background. So this is the image that I created. And what was happening before we made this change was, you can even see it here, the image doesn't go quite to the edge of the screen. And when I talked to Kurt about it, he explained that it's because this image isn't tied to the camera the same way that the other images are, because it's on a special shape that does generation of particles. So we've given a slider in here to allow you to change that shape size so that it actually does reach the end of your screen. But that's why it's so important to make sure before you start that your design computer is set to the resolution of your display, because when this thing is rendered, when it's all converted over to a LUMOplay app, if you open it on a display that is not the right resolution, it may not scale properly. So you definitely want to make sure that you're designing for the display resolution that you are going to be using in your final installation. So some of the other options here, right now it's set to twinkle glow, so I'm going to change that to nebula as well. And I'm going to turn my image transparency all the way down. So I don't actually want to see that original image, I just want to see the particles that are generated from that image. And I'm going to turn my particle size up a little bit so that you can see the shape a little bit better. The particle density by default is always cranked. This looks good for some particles and isn't perfect for others. So if there's something you want to do and it's not giving you enough particles, you can order something custom from us, but it needs to be tested. If you added more particles in, it would probably slow down the effect quite a bit. And then particle velocity, I'm going to turn up, and that will make the particles move quite a bit more. And I'm not really gonna rotate them too much, but just a little bit so that they always look like they're moving. And what's kind of cool about this is if you watch carefully, every time those particles in the background that are just a video, they're not interactive, but every time they hit one of these white particles, it looks like they're pulling them apart, which is kind of cool. It's a byproduct of the filters we're using. It wasn't intentional, but it looks amazing. And that's one of the fun things about making generative art, is just finding those weird little things that happen by accident that end up looking really cool. So that's it. That's all the things I need to do to make this effect. I'm just gonna call it Vortex. And now I'm just gonna save it and close this. It's saved the effect with this really cool thumbnail so that I can find it, and I just need to publish it. There are two different versions of LUMOplay. One is LUMO Playground and the other is LUMO Playmaker. LUMO Playground licenses are sold at what we calculate to be our cost. So it's basically what it costs us to host the licenses and keep our salaries paid, cover our overhead. We don't really make a profit on Playground licenses. So there is a pay-as-you-go fee when you make a custom app. If you upgrade to LUMO Playmaker, which is our agency and creator license, then those costs are all covered, so you can make as many custom apps as you want to. So I'm going to click publish, and it's not going to take me to a payment page, but if you're using Playground, you may have to go through an additional step of paying for your app. And then you just get a warning that says that you won't be able to edit the app again once it's been published, so make sure that you are really happy with your app before you hit that publish button. And yeah, it's uploading, and once it's uploaded, you'll be able to play your custom app from any installation that is running from your account. I hope you enjoyed this week's tutorial as much as I enjoyed making it. I really have been enjoying creating new content for you every single week, and I really want to say thank you to everybody who's left a comment and everyone who's shared the video or reached out and emailed me directly. I got a really sweet email last week from somebody who just reached out to thank us for making LUMOplay. And as you may or may not know, our team is very small. We're only 4 people, and we keep our software prices as low as possible because we know that setting up an interactive experience is a pretty big expense for most people. And a lot of the people that use our software are not-for-profits and schools and teachers and parents with kids who have special needs. We really, really want to support you, and we're really grateful for the support that you've shown us. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments, or you can reach me at info@lumoplay.com. And if you're enjoying the stuff that we're creating, please hit the subscribe button. Again, it helps us a lot. We don't invest anything into advertising, so this is the way that we reach you all, and the more people who engage with our content, the more people we can reach. I'll see you again next week with another tutorial.